Hello there, fans of Acid Horizon. This is Craig here. Thank you once again for joining us for another great episode. Today we interview John Protevi on the topic of non-state societies, anarchist anthropology, and the work of Deleuze and Guattari. If you are not already a patron with us, now is a good time to join. We have an upcoming seminar with Jeremy R. Smith on the topic of François Laruelle and a recent essay that Jeremy himself translated. In the upcoming days, you will see some more recordings from us on our Patreon account. Moreover, we have some recordings already there for you if you haven't joined us already. Other ways that you can support our podcast is to find our merch store in the links below or check out any one of our blogs, which you'll also find in the show notes. Okay, let's get to the episode. Welcome to Acid Horizon, the theory podcast. Today, Will and I are joined by John Protevi. He is a professor of French studies at Louisiana University. He has written a myriad of books on Deleuze, the politics of affect, and geophilosophy. He has also written a proverbial ton of extraordinarily helpful guides, outlines, and lectures about the works of Foucault and Deleuze. His most recent book, published by Minnesota University Press, Edges of the State, ties together contemporary discourses in the sciences with the radical anthropology of Clastres and Scott, and of course, the philosophy of Deleuze and Guattari. So welcome to our show today, John.
Thanks, I appreciate the invitation. Just got my power on about an hour and a half ago after Hurricane Ida.
How's everything else down there? Are you safe? Are your friends and family safe?
It was fine. It was 5 days without power, but I could go to the campus and get a little air conditioning there.
Well, I should say I'm glad that you're safe and with us here today. So let's go into talking about the book. We have several questions that we'd like to ask, and hopefully we can develop some discussions that I think our listeners will be interested in. So a lot of the themes and foundational elements in your other works are present in Edges of the State, such as the relationship between cognitive science and Deleuzian scholarship. But this book sets out an explicitly political and anthropological direction, one that takes figures such as Deleuze, not only Deleuze, but Clastres as important. What compelled you to write Edges of the State?
Well, I became interested in anthropology a few years ago, so just in reading along with that, I wanted to challenge this notion that there's a kind of a straight line towards a view of human nature, which is competitive, aggressive, and suspicious of strangers. I don't take the opposite position on that, but what I do think that human beings are is invested in the social patterns of their societies. So that can be both intellectual and emotionally invested in things. So depending on circumstance, you can have more or less cosmopolitan versus nationalist or suspicion of strangers versus kind of let's all live together in a big setting. So that, those were part of the motivations behind writing the book. I didn't want to let the discourse on human nature be dominated by those who would look back to, say, chimpanzee intergroup violence and say, aha, this shows that human beings are innately predisposed to warfare. And in the anthropology that I've been reading, that's a big question as to how far back in human evolution warfare can be said to take place. No one denies that human beings kill each other. They get jealous. There's, you know, sexual rivalries, you know, people get angry. There's fights and murders. Whether those are organized, in which entire groups fight other groups anonymously, as it were, that's a topic that has a large and bitterly discussed thesis. So I dove into that. I kind of thought that the people who propose that war is a social condition rather than a natural impulse. You can never tell whether I'm predisposed to that because of my politics. And so, hey, I thought that they won the argument or whatever, but it did seem to me to be a defensible position. And so I wanted to to take up that position and explain it with an interface between philosophy and anthropology, and specifically Deleuze, since Deleuze and Guattari do cite a number of anthropologists like Glasler. And I think they would have liked James C. Scott. I thought I would bring some of those guys together. Then I also had Rousseau in there because he's a favorite. And part of the book comes out of teaching a course called Evolution in Biology and Morality. Mm. And so I've taught over many years a variety of different books from that. And so I kind of pieced together the book. So it's one of those happy occasions that humanists sometimes find themselves in, that my research was able to be synergized with my teaching, much more so than some particle physicist is not going to walk into, you know, physics 101 and be able to talk with students. But I could talk with my students about, is war part of human nature, or are we just violent?
One of the interesting parts of the beginning of the book, well, there's two things. You talk about primatology and how the examples of bonobo and chimpanzee societies are often used as, by laypersons as maybe grist for the mill of the idea that we have warlike origins. But evidently in these communities, there are salient instances of social collaboration. In the primate world, what do you see as the best or the most salient evidence that we have a genetic linkage to a species that has instances of social collaboration that mirror ours in some way?
That's a big topic. I mean, we are, though chimps and bonobos are our most closely related cousins, right? But the line that became Homo sapiens, along with lots of other lines, Neanderthals and so on and so forth, that line split from the line that became the current pan genus, which includes chimps and bonobos, somewhere between 6 to 8 million years ago. So one of the big issues is to beware of a tendency to take contemporary instances either of non-state people or of chimps and bonobos and think of them as living fossils, right? So anthropology has been riven with discussions about whether people commit that sin. Well, everybody says, you know, we don't do that, but there's problems with trying to kind of triangulate the behavior patterns of the three remaining ancestors, human beings, chimps, and bonobos.
It's almost like an inversion of the mistake in some way to look for social collaboration in those societies and to create that map.
I mean, we're all hypersocial. All three of those species are hypersocial. Now, I think the bonobos as the hippies of the animal kingdom is exaggerated. You know, they are primates, and you know, their famous social sexuality does have some power relations to it. Often, it's said that they indulge in non-reproductive sex to settle disputes. Well, there had to be disputes in the first place, right?
So right.
Bonobos are not hippies, chimps, but there are reliable reports of differences in chimp and bonobo behavior. For instance, chimps are quite hierarchical, and they have an alpha male, and they are able to coerce sex from the females. And so there are lots of complications there, because it might look like the alpha has like a harem of the female chimps, but in fact, the arguments are made that the reproductive success of the alpha isn't that much greater than that of other males in the pack. So some primatologists would say that the female chimps can sort of hedge their bets by having some mating on the side, rather than chimp society can have an alpha stays in power by recruiting a coalition. But it's, you know, inherently unstable, and you know, there can be revolts, and alphas are going to die at some point. So it's a little bit, but it's hierarchical, and they do have violent relations among groups. At least there's testimony. Now, some people argue that those are just the result of human interference. Like, we know that contemporary chimps have violent relations among their groups. Does that predict the way the last common ancestor behaved, the LCA, which is the one that gave birth to all those? We don't know. And some people would claim, in fact, that chimpanzee intergroup violence, rather than being some deeply embedded genetic continuity, is in fact itself a adaptive response to the shrinking of their environment and the provisioning of by human primatologists, kind of provoke those kind of things. So it's a huge, highly specialized discourse that I just try to skate along the edges of and try to establish some of the boundaries of the discourse for the readers. I try to see myself as translating some of the primate literature in terms that would connect with political philosophy and French philosophy.
A large portion of the arguments in the introduction or the introductory chapters of the book involve bringing in evolutionary psychology and neuroscience into this analysis. One of the parts that stood out to me was talking about how over the course of human civilization, there has been instances in which strongmen would be killed by tribes or bands, and this may have impacted the genetic pool by and large. Now, I'm thinking from a post-structuralist perspective how that sort of claim could factor into a greater analysis. There's a challenging biological implications that some other presuppositions about human nature and whatnot could get ushered in. How do you square these sort of regimes of analysis, if you want to call them that, you know, between evolutionary psychology, genetics, neuroscience, and the work of Deleuze and Guattari, for example?
One of the anthropological concepts I explain in the book is called the human self-domestication thesis. And that looks at the development of the egalitarian social formations, foragers, right? And so a standard reading is that for quite some time, mobile foragers were enforced their egalitarianism by ridicule, exile, and if necessary, capital punishment against bullies and shirkers, you know, those who would free ride, but also those who would take, and especially those who would kill others. They were considered kind of mad dogs. So people like Christopher Bohm talks about what he calls social selection, and that's integrated into this Brian Hare, who has a big article on the human self-domestication thesis. If you look at bonobos tend to have more, their brains are developed in anger management, let's say, just to be quick about it, in ways that are intermediate between chimpanzees and us. We are able to exert executive control, right, in anger situations. I'd have to go back and reread a lot of it, but that's the main idea, that we have these anger management capacities. You could say that some of those genes for really quick take anger without a lot of executive control may have been selected out of our population, of our genetic descent by mechanisms of social selection, that is killing the alphas. I mean, it's really fascinating and interesting thesis. So there's a number of people who take that up. Now, as I was saying, we cannot look at contemporary non-state people, nomadic foragers, and simply see them as direct descendants, as living fossils. Nonetheless, it is well attested to that you will find these kind of capital punishment maneuvers in non-state people. So by careful triangulating these, you know, brilliant professional anthropologists, you know, who write their books and articles, I just try to translate some of what they're saying. What got me interested in it is that Pierre Clastres, who was a French political anthropologist in the 1970s who studied the South American Yanomamo, well, I'm sure it was the Yanomamo, but the Amazonian tribes, came up with a thesis that their society was against the state. And the major way that they, one of the major ways they did that was by having their chiefs gain prestige by fighting in the front lines of warfare. Right. Well, of course, it's a great way to get your chief killed. Right, so you interrupt the nepotism angle that way. Those folks tend to be kind of sedentary horticulturalists, right? So they have, so it's a chiefdom position and not really rigorous egalitarians. So Baum would say that the foragers are both anti-war and anti-state. So while the horticulturalists are anti-state by means of war, Baum and some other folks would say that the foragers are anti-state and anti-war. Yeah, the thesis is put forth by an anthropologist by the name of Raymond Kelly, who has a book called Warless Societies and the Origin of War. So his idea is that in non-segmented societies, non-clan and family-based societies in which there's a lot of interchange between groups, like bands or more like temporary coagulations around a campfire. If you don't like the way we do it, you just head down the road where you're going to meet somebody you used to hunt with, who's an uncle or a cousin, and you camp with them for a while. So this kind of strong in-group, out-group thing doesn't seem to hold until you get to agriculture.
Yeah,
I have to put an asterisk on that because we're going to come back to that. So Kelly's idea is that you, at a certain state of social complexity, you can get family obligations to revenge a death in the family. And that's on the way to feud and vendetta, and that's on the way to war. Because then instead of someone individually being responsible for their actions, and then maybe you can get their family to take care of this guy for us, right? Kind of negotiated way. It becomes a point of honor that somebody in your family killed one of our families, my family's going to vendetta against your family, and that's on the way to war, Kelly says. In the background, a lot of the anthropology stuff, although I'm not a Rousseau, I'm not completely a Rousseau stan, nonetheless, he lays out a thesis that origin of agriculture was a hugely important marker in human social formations.
Right.
I don't ever want to say development of human social formations. That's people don't talk that way anymore. The James C. Scott book that I look in here makes it a much more complicated stuff because there are forms of sedentary life which are non-agricultural, but people are able to kind of settle down in a resource-rich environment in which the food comes to them. So paradigmatically, on the side of the salmon runs, right? You can settle down. You don't have agriculture, but the food's coming to you, and you can get hierarchy there, chiefdoms, and slavery. There's a lot of stuff in that position. So it's not really acephalic, egalitarian hunters and gatherers.
Right.
And then state agriculture, armies, right, so on and so forth. There's a lot of intermediary stages, but that's not intermediary on a development. It's just a given social.
It's a dispersal.
Yeah.
Non-teleological.
Yes, it's an abstract machine.
Right. So yeah, that's a better word.
Certain ecological circumstances correlate with certain social formations. It's certainly the case that human beings are capable of war. And we have lots of evidence of war. Once you have sedentary populations and you have portable goods, right? So that can be women for reproductive purposes. It can be grain, you know, anything that's been stored or stocked. The claim against forager warfare would go something like this, that adult male foragers are very skilled hunters. So you don't really want to take those guys back to your tribe because, number one, there's nothing for them to do except go out hunting with you. So you don't want to enslave someone and then give them a spear and go out hunting with them.
Right.
Because accidents will happen.
Of course.
There doesn't seem to be anything to gain. And in fact, if you look at, again, you have to triangulate carefully, but if you look at contemporary forger behaviors, there's a strong thesis that meat and hunting would tend to produce a kind of excess that couldn't be consumed by the band. So what you do is you invite your neighbors in, and you create a webs of social obligation that way.
Right.
They call it resource variance insurance. If your hunt in the next 2 weeks doesn't go well, your buddies down the road, you had just had them over for a huge barbecue.
Right.
Just 2 weeks ago. And so they're obligated to invite you back. In fact, when things get dicey, your resource variance insurance is not stocking stuff. It's having social relations.
Right. In that sense, that's how debt functions in these sort of mobile or globular blocks.
I mean, David Graeber in his debt book, I think, says that narrowly construed, debt is a market society relationship. Because if you and I have a contract, right, suppose you had sent me $50 to do this thing, right? Once I had showed up, I cashed your check, we have nothing more to do with each other.
I see.
In a contract relationship. Right? Here, we do have something to do with each other because we didn't exchange money. We had made a social relation.
Right, right, right.
You know, if I need to, I can say, hey, can you send me a copy of that podcast or whatever? I would kind of technically say that they're webs of obligation. Mm-hmm. But Deleuze Guattari used the term debt. And I think that from holdover from the way Nietzsche talked about debt.
Right.
So Graeber's critique, I think, is correct that if you're looking at creditor-debtor as atoms who establish a relationship, call it a contract, at the end of which they go their separate ways, then that has nothing to do with forger society. In fact, it has nothing much to do with everyday life today.
And the function of the term debt in both Deleuze and Guattari, and then, of course, Nietzsche, it kind of collapses. It imposes upon non-state society's sense of obligation, the modernist or the statist sense of obligation onto that. Would you say then, I mean, could it just be a verbal dispute in some sense in that the adhesive quality of social obligation in non-state societies, it's a little bit stickier, the fingerprint of it looks a little bit different, and then as we move into state societies, we don't see that in the same way?
Correct.
Okay.
That's the Graeber line. So like I said, with my classes all the time, if your neighbor comes to borrow your, you know, the cup of sugar, right? And then the next day they show up and they've written you a check for $1.14, which is the cost of the sugar plus interest. You don't want anything to do with this guy the rest of your life.
Right, right.
But that's a contract, right? So we don't even do most contracts, certainly within the kind of theory of the firm, you push the contracts to the outside relationship. It seems to me that neoliberalism has completely fucked all that up because now they try to institute quasi-contractual relationships within the university. I have to, you know, we have to rent our office space and we have to compete with, if not contractual relationships, at least competitive relationships between the departments who are all fighting for majors or whatever. Right. So there's a whole way in which that tensions and conflicts and frictions between obligation behavior and contract behavior is.
See, in some way, I think that's a somewhat of a vindication of Nietzsche in the sense that the form of debt changes such that it occupies a different time and space. It's infinitizing and it's universalizing and particularizing all simultaneously.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, I think that it's very tricky discourse there in the third chapter, third part of Anti-Oedipus, the three social structures that they analyze, they do want to track the different forms of debt. So the infinite debt to the emperor, and then it becomes the infinite debt to capital, which is literally true now. In fact, there's a very nice book, The Time of Money, give a shout out.
Oh, sure. Yeah, let's do that. That's one of the things we want to get is reading lists.
The Time of Money, and it's in a kind of discourse network with someone named Melinda Cooper. It's The Time of Money,
yes,
not Melinda Cooper's book. But
although she has an excellent book on the family.
Yeah, Family Values is great. But the idea is that once, you know, when you securitize debt today, the issuers of the debt are not interested at all in me paying off my 30-year mortgage. They just want me to hit the monthly note.
Right.
So, yeah, you're always in debt. So there is a literal way in which the infinite debt to capital is made concrete today.
The brilliance of it, too, is like you could just speak to it from a perspective of like a 20-something-year-old, right? The very needing to exist in such a way that you do have debt is that which allows you to take on more debt, right? If you don't have a sufficient enough credit history, So you have to have been indebted before. So your very participation in like labor extraction practices, like being, for example, a graduate student in some ways has to be predicated on a certain level of debt to meet that threshold.
Yep, there's lots of good stuff. I haven't completely followed up on a lot of it, but Lazzarato is beginning of Indebted Man and stuff. The author of Time of Money is Lisa Adkins.
Yeah, Lisa Adkins, okay.
She is from Stanford University Press.
Excellent.
You open the text with sort of a treatment of a particular disaster, the media ecology surrounding the tragedy in Haiti. And then you spend a lot of time talking about the securitization of disaster response discourses. Mm-hmm. And you sort of use that milieu as sort of one initial frame to take for the book and the stakes. And I think it works well. It's a great way to lay out the stakes. And you talk about a comment made by one CNN correspondent where the way that they were looking at the response to the Haiti disaster, because so much of it was about, it's standard of Western media, right, is that it's this, you know, disastrous nightmare of the global South falling apart, and all of these different NGOs and state actors need to come in. But then a CNN correspondent says they became their own first responders. And of course, there's a brilliant irony in that, right? And having to impose the very notion of a first responder, right? Because they can't perceive of a community action outside of that hyperstructuration. But can you talk a little bit about what some of the forces that underwrite the way in which we talk about community action in response to disasters, some of the ways in which our anthropological discourses sort of feed these kind of discussions and frameworks that come out further down on the line, all the way to what's on your television screen in your living room.
Yep. Well, I mean, I actually got onto that in 2005, having lived through Katrina and seen a lot of the debates about looters and so on and so forth. So there's sort of classic media criticism where, you know, the Associated Press has some, you know, white folks who have gone, you know, foraging or something, that, you know, they're pushing a shopping bag, a shopping cart through the water, right? And they've gone to get supplies. And then another news agency had some black folks who were looting. That was pretty classic. So that really got me started on it. And there's very good Social Science Now, a lot of the people out of the University of Delaware Disaster Relief Center. So it's very well attested to that in the immediate aftermath of most disasters, you will get a huge community binding and self-help thing. So this was popularized and in a very, really nice book, great book, by Rebecca Solnit called Paradise Born in Hell. But Katrina played a big role in that. That got me started in following up on a lot of the stuff. Now, it's true that after 4 or 5 days, when people are, you know, tired and hungry and so on and so forth, there might be some more individualistic and atomistic stuff. The one exception is fire in a crowded building. Then it's every man for himself. But hurricanes, earthquakes, floods, stuff like that, there's a lot of. So famously, you saw people in the Cajun Navy in Katrina when people came to New Orleans and got in their boats and drove around and rescued people. So yeah, I just kind of turned it around and said that the current state has to work really hard to enforce an atomization. And when the state breaks down, you don't see atomization as you would be predicted by Hobbes. Well, on a certain reading of Hobbes, in fact, you see social bonding. Right. Now, Hobbes, I think, actually says that what you would end up with in a long, drawn-out civil war is gang warfare. When he says a war of all against all, I think he means factions. And, you know, he lives through the English Civil War. So it doesn't mean absolutely individualist.
Right.
But the nonetheless, the Hobbesian expectation is in a lot of this reporting. You know, looting, dog-eat-dog kind of stuff, where, in fact, at least the first couple of days, yeah. So the guy who said their own first responders is a guy named Russell Honoré, who is a lieutenant general in the Army, and he was in charge of the Katrina relief effort, and he was the one who told because they had militarized the Katrina relief effort, stopping the volunteer social response. And he was, when he got in charge, he said, look, you know, we're not occupying the city, put your guns away. It's certainly the case that people can benefit from the coordination and logistics provided for, you know, there's three stages. There's rescue, there's relief, and then there's securitization. Mm-hmm. So, rescue and relief, it's fine to get coordination and logistics from state organizations. But the actual first, and I use the term first responder, or he uses the term first responders to kind of demythologize the cops and the firemen, who are second responders. Now, often they have to get other people out of the way who are trying to help, but don't have the training and techniques and the equipment. Right, but that's what he meant by saying that. Now, obviously, the reason why Haiti was so fragilized has to everything to do with the history of the punishments of the people after the Haitian Republic in 1804. You know, and the hundreds of years of punishment of that revolt. That the state can, in its best instances, provide organization, logistical support, and so on and so forth, should be seen as coordinating and taking advantage of what was already started by the people on the spot.
Mm, right.
So that was the whole thing. And that does not have to be family either. There's lots of reports out of Katrina of not just the Cajun Navy, but everybody was helping people get out of the neighborhood and so on and so forth. So the rumors of sexual violence during Katrina are just straight replays of the rumors and fantasies of what would happen in slave revolts.
It's amazing how much of that is part of the political imagination of Americans. It reminds me of a film like Cormac McCarthy's The Road, for example, in which you have complete and utter social breakdown with no context given. So it's almost like a pure stratum in which this fantasy plays out. You know, you have warlords, tribes, and bands, and they're all violent, cannibalizing each other. And the biggest fear is to allow the family to persist and then survive, perhaps in one of these, you know, more benevolent groups. That's strangely enough, on the coast. It's not inland. There's another dimension to the fantasy there too.
I mean, it's these forms of like rhetorical violence also like end up becoming like physical, real violence. Particularly as we look at like what's happened in Brooklyn this week. If we look at the way in which that storm has affected at least that borough. Like, it's a particular kind of environmental racism that put a lot of folks in those communities in that position. So I think, too, when we talk about like response, it's also about the way in which populations are like historically dispersed, and the looting rhetoric around Katrina like still persists in a lot of like political discourse today. I don't know how far even though we're removed, you know, quite a long time from that disaster, I think a lot of that still persists in the way in which we talk about responses to contemporary issues pertaining to climate. But one more thing about this book that I think is unique is, to shift gears again, the treatment of ideology, which tends to be, at least in Deleuze-Guattarian studies, something that is treated perpetually in opposition to, just say, like the Althusserian framework. And in your book, there's this work to sort of introduce affect into that discussion. Now, of course, there's a lot of work on political affect going on. Sarah Ahmed's one of the folks that leads a lot of the scholarship there. But this seemed to take a slightly different tact, because it was still maintaining an interest in cognitive science, biology, and anthropology. Can you speak a little bit to what an affective approach to ideology looks like, and what some of the tendencies you're responding to in academia pertaining to how we look at systems of social reproduction?
Well, Deleuze and Guattari's target in Anti-Oedipus is Wilhelm Reich. Yeah, so they're very, I mean, they were somewhat trollish, you know, so their line is ideology is the most execrable concept. Right? Mm-hmm. So they go on and on about that. They, fairly or not, I would have to go read Reich a lot more carefully than I've ever read him, but they sort of paint him as looking only at belief structures and opposing rationality and emotion in ways. And their thing is to say that the infrastructure is, you know, there's a direct libidinal investment of the social. So there's desire in the infrastructure. That's their line. So you can't get a political critique of a society that just shows the irrationality of the society, as if we could just get people's beliefs in line with the actual way in which the society works, then we could, you know, get them out of the way. And so they, like with a lot of their guys, they say, Reich asked a really good question. He really pushed it, right? He said that fascism, you know, under certain social conditions, the German people wanted fascism, you know, the Q people want fascism, right? So they're not fooled, right? What is the desire structure? What are the social conditions that lead to fascist desire? Right? And Reich poses that question, and Deleuze Guattari think they don't follow through on. The reason they don't like ideology is they assume it's just targeting beliefs. And we could just do that. And I think that, you know, fairly or unfairly, I kind of take that over to some contemporary analytic folks. They themselves have some more recognition of the role that emotion plays in ideology. So I'm thinking of Jason Stanley is the guy that I wrote a couple of pages on, but I would have to be more careful to look at Sally Haslinger and Tommy Shelby and a bunch of the other analytic folks on ideology. But what Jason Stanley does is say that emotions, specifically love of family and social identity, will anchor beliefs into a subject. So it's hard to give up your beliefs about the way the world works, because it would mean disappointing your family. Right? So you can imagine somebody at LSU who has to get vaccinated and they come from an anti-vax family. I think we've kind of taken the, provided an excuse for them, because they can always say to mom and dad, I had to get, you know, they forced my hand. I didn't do this voluntarily. But that would be a thing. If the person was going to come home at Christmas or Thanksgiving and say, yeah, you know, I thought about it, mom and dad. I know you're anti-vax, but I got vaxxed. I mean, that's a really tough thing to happen to have to do. Right? So that's Jason's idea, that your social position, you have a lot of love connections that build into your identity, and that anchors beliefs in place. And I think that's great. I think it's correct, but I don't think it goes far enough. And so I showed the way in which one of the ways to get away from ideology is to say that it's superfluous nowadays, because we have such a capacity to build in collective action problems. The cops will pick off, you know, or you can't get in the way in which union organizers can be fired and you have to sue to get back, or the way in which cops can pick off, you know, infiltrate and pick off revolutionaries, then you produce a collective action problem such that people, it doesn't matter what people believe, right? You sort of want to put your head, you know, stick your head up. And I thought, yes, that is true. However, some of the people, the forces of order themselves, still have to buy in. There has to be some emotional buy-in to the people who are going to enforce that kind of thing. And even if you're somebody, your run-of-the-mill cops aren't completely bought into it, right? Internal affairs will be. So there's kind of nested ways in which you have enforcers and those who supervise and enforce the enforcement. So I didn't think that the collective action idea, whereas, you know, you would be vulnerable if you stuck your head up and tried to make waves. While that certainly is very effective, I don't think it completely covers the whole situation. There has to be buy-in, and that buy-in has to be affective and emotional. They have to want to crack heads.
One of the ways that I read Deleuze and Guattari's notion of desire versus ideology is that it just doesn't encompass something like affect. The social field is comprised of numerous technical machines, which in some instances are correlates of ideas and even emotions.
Sure, in the United States.
Absolutely.
It's tied in, like, you know, you get laid in the back of the car.
Right.
Mode.
Right.
It's huge. That's why they put, you know, chicks in bikinis to sell sports cars. So there's huge investment into social. That's why Elon Musk isn't laughed out of the building. You've seen that meme where there's, Elon Musk, somebody criticizes Elon Musk, and hundreds of weirdos throw themselves in Twitter to protect Musk. There's some weird thing about the genius. You know, I mean, they conflate him with Tony Stark.
Of course, yeah. They're like ideological monuments, yeah.
The point is very well taken. The technical machines get hugely loaded with libido, is what they call it. Yeah.
I think even Deleuze says as much in one instance when he talks about highways. You know, like, we don't get to choose where the highways are put as individuals or as families. But, you know, I know it's meant as an analogy between desire and interest, in the same way that Dan Smith's, you know, sort of renders that issue. But, you know, at the same time, like, we can only go where the highway goes if we do have that Tesla. And so that brings to bear upon so many other aspects of the machinic unconscious and desiring machines, if you will.
I mean, maybe one way to start doing this is to just really just nail down this concept of pro-socialization versus some of the overwhelming tendencies that you find in some of the scholarship that you think has contributed to a lot of these problematizable notions that kind of seem to be at the center of the book. So you talk about how, I don't even want to say combative, because that could be, there's a connotation there that could be a problem, but combat opposition, antisocial behavioral tendencies tend to ground a lot of the ways in which we sort of by default treat these anthropological questions. And you offer sort of an alternative, which is to instead just maybe try to engage in these inquiries with the default setting of pro-sociality, just to see what would happen if we took this sort of framework of the joyful encounter rather than the fundamentally oppositional or one ground in opposition. So can you just talk about the ways in which you think that this new form of anthropological inquiry can lead to sort of a more open discourse about these questions that end up having sort of a political intensity?
Pro-sociality for me just means that you're emotionally and intellectually invested in the social patterns of the society in which you grow up. That can have a negative slant too, like you hate things, right? It's just that people are very rarely cold and just follow rules because they've internalized a set of rules. Mm-hmm. Right? I think rather people are emotionally invested in that. Now, one of the ways in which that comes out is to say that people are willing to punish third-party violators of social patterns, even though they don't impact your own family. There's a long discourse on altruism in anthropology. And if you think of organisms as a kind of unit of selection, it seems odd that altruistic behavior, which would be behavior that sacrifices some fitness element for the sake of another organism, would have ever survived. Well, they kind of finesse that by saying, well, if you have kin involved, right, then you could have kin selection. So I could sacrifice myself for two brothers or eight cousins, as the slogan goes. But you could also then say, well, you're just going to get a delayed response, or you could have reciprocal altruism, so I could help you, knowing that now you owe me. Or you could mutualism, we could both work together and we both get our reward at the same time. And lastly, there would be indirect reciprocity, in which I do something and gain a good reputation by it. Right? So it's kind of way in which they always want to show that, you know, there's always something in it for the person who doesn't. There's never any pure altruism. And I think that's fine. I mean, I think our job is to arrange society such that it benefits people when they help others. I think that's kind of got a spinocist ring to it. What I wanted to get away from is the idea that it's only the fear of the cops that keep us from being complete rational egoists, meaning I would calculate everything and only do those things that would benefit me. And that does not seem to me, it seems more cumbersome than necessary. I think we have direct libidinal investment in the social. So that's the Deleuze-Guattari bit. So reading that, a couple of big names, guy Kim Sterelny, Sterelny, and also Michael Tomasello. Sarah Herdy is another, but they look at moments in our hominin ancestry in which collaboration became an ecological necessity. And that could either be collective breeding for Herdy, collective foraging or collaborative foraging for Tomasello. And Sterelny has some others he likes to emphasize, apprenticeship and this, that, and the other thing. But there became a time in which there was a selection pressure for people who were emotionally attuned to the other people in their group and who were willing to commit and to work hard. And they became invested in seeing the reproduction of the social patterns. So that's what pro-sociality means. Doesn't that mean being nice? Right. Can result in punishment.
Sure.
If you violate the social patterns. Yeah, so that's where I wanted to, just to get away from this idea that really collective action and authority figures keep people from doing what they really want to do, which is to be selfish.
So, John, I think we have one more kind of big question before we wrap it up. Will, go ahead.
Sure. And just it really does just line up with this idea of the necessity for, an Apollonian governing figure to come in and organize the self-invested, chaotic nature of like the selfish human being that renders life, cold and intolerable. If when we take this opposing viewpoint, when we start to look for these other moments in the history of species, how do you think we can apply it to the way in which we engage in contemporary political projects, the way in which we engage with the problems of power as they exist today?
Yeah, I mean that's a big, it's a big thing. I mean, you mentioned joy a few minutes ago, and it's not absolutely not, using a Spinozist line of thought, that's not an ironclad normative principle, right? Because the fascists absolutely are joyous. So you have to do some sort of thing about where you get joy from empowering and turning other people on in ways that don't make you dependent on a despotic figure, like someone who delivers the truth to you, like in a cue drop, or that you don't have to libidinally invest in Trump. The replaying of the 2016 primary, which Bernie Bros are the reason why Texas law was passed. Right. I mean, there should be. So I hope I would lean towards some sort of anarchist view in which people are mutually empowering each other. It doesn't mean that charismatic figures are always bad, but I do think we can have alarm bells should ring when we see this kind of joy in forming a community that's dedicated to the transcendent despotic figure.
Yeah, it's an investment in a sort of transcendent structure, whether that be like that. This is what male fantasy sort of talks about, and Anti-Oedipus as well, more directly. So I think that's great. Beyond that, we should just shout out the work that you've done at your website.
www.protevi.com/John.
Okay, perfect. Because I think every graduate student who's done any research, I'm sure many undergrads who have done any research on Dolez and Guattari has found your work helpful. So the collection of like drafts, research papers, outlines, lectures, lecture notes, things like that. So they're helpful resources.
I'm still going back on there. I remember last year around this time, I read The Birth of Tragedy, and I think you have an outline, and I just use that as a way to navigate around the text. Mm-hmm. So thank you for all of your work.
That's indebted to person at Essex, Beatrice Han Pyle. But anyway, I appreciate that, guys. I got to go. We're going to go to the store and refill our fridge.
Oh, yes.
Throw out all our food.
Yeah, please stay safe. You've done a great service to the community of listeners, and thank you.
So send me the link.
Absolutely. Thank you.